So, good afternoon. I'm Christopher. I do a bi-weekly podcast about spaceflight called Countdown Podcast, and I now want to talk to you about new space. Most of you will know who this guy is. For those of you who don't, this is Elon Musk, founder and current CEO of SpaceX. They launch, and what is most interesting for most people, land rockets on a ship at sea. This is at least my experience. When I talk to people who are in some way interested in spaceflight, they will know about SpaceX and at varying degrees something more about the new space scene in general, but SpaceX is the most common denominator. Most common they know. And I now want to broaden your understanding of the new space scene. First, I want to define what the term new space means, and then I will talk a bit about the different firms, which are more promising, which are less promising, and then I have some broader question about the future of spaceflight in general, and hopefully some discussion afterwards with you. First of all, if you look at the Wikipedia page of New Space, you are presented with this sentence. New Space, formerly Alt Space, also Space, also New Space, Entrepreneurial Space, Entrepreneurship, and Commercial Space are umbrella terms for a movement and philosophy encompassing a highly visible, globally emerging private spaceflight industry. So it's a movement and a philosophy. To be honest, this sounds like it was written by the PR department of a new space firm. It reflects some sort of Silicon Valley mindset that it's not just business you are doing, you are part of a movement, you have a philosophy. And to be honest, I personally would not 100% agree with this definition. So, to understand what new space actually means, we have to look at the history of the last 20 years or 17 years. The new space scene we have now started around the 2000s, then where Blue Origin was founded, SpaceX was founded, and important in the history of governmental or national spaceflight, some big changes happened. In 2003, the Space Shuttle Columbia disintegrated upon re-entry. After that, President George W. Bush tried to steer public focus away from the Space Shuttle program and initiated the Commercial Orbital Transportation Service program, short COTS. This is a chart of the COTS program. You see you have the different parts of resupplying the International Space Station. You have the launch, rendezvous, disposal of the trash, cargo return, and crew return. And all these things were done by national launch provider like the Space Shuttle or the Soyuz spacecraft from Russia. And they wanted to source out these services to commercial firms, and the COTS was to fund different firms, in the final rounds then two firms, to develop two spacecrafts to provide at first cargo resupply services and on the second stage crew resupply services. The first stage was completed with the development of the Dragon freighter we have on the left and the Cygnus freighter we have on the right, which was developed by Orbital ATK. They do their job, they resupply the International Space Station with supplies, and the second part is still just theory. We have on the left again the Crew Dragon capsule developed by SpaceX, which will fly something around 2018 the first time, and to the end of 2018 they want to launch the first astronauts to the International Space Station. On the right we have the CST-100 Starliner, which is currently developed by Boeing, which will launch for the first time they plan to at the end of 2018 and then bring astronauts to the International Space Station something around 2019. But those two programs are just still just theory. Everything the commercial orbital transportation and services does currently is bringing supplies to the space station. So the history shows the United States were very eager to fund commercial spaceflight, or in a narrow definition, new space flight, and that provided a fertile ground for further developments of new space firms. We have some problematic things happening in national spaceflight, which also contributed to the development of new space. On the left, you see a rendering of the Space Launch System, which is currently developed by NASA and will serve as, you could say, a replacement or follow-up program to the Space Shuttle program. And in a bigger sense, it will serve as a second Saturn V. They planned to use this rocket to build the follow-up space station to the ISS called Deep Space Gateway, which will stationed in a translunar space, so it will fly around the Moon and to Earth and back. And this space launch system should have flown 2018, no, 2019, no, 2020. So you see there are big problems. I call it the BER of spaceflight, because you can every month you can read something about the software is not working or the whole timeline is fucked up. So that's still problematic. So the focus of even deep space exploration is currently, or the hope is currently, lying on new space firm in some way. On the right, you have the RD-180 engine, a Russian engine, which is currently used by ULA, the United Launch Alliance, on the Atlas V rocket. United Launch Alliance is a joint venture of Boeing and Lockheed Martin to provide satellite launches. They are a very well-established firm. And after the fall of the Soviet Union, they bought very cheap those RD-180 engines, or the contract to build them, to import them to the United States. And with the beginning of the Ukraine conflict, the US Senate tried to ban the use of the RD-118 on launches with governmental contracts. So the ULA also launches spy satellites for the US military, and it does not look politically very good if you launch your spy satellites with rocket engines from the enemy, or let's say some sort of enemy, because at any time Russia could stop the import from their side, and then the US were without satellite launch capability. So they tried to ban it preemptively to force the United Launch Alliance to develop a new engine, and that gave opportunity to SpaceX to gain governmental contracts for spy satellites or military satellite launches, which also provided them with a big cash inflow. Those spy satellite launches are very expensive and are a very lucrative business for any spaceflight firm. So, you see, the history provided new space with a good environment to thrive, but one question remains: is there a bubble? And to think about that, is there a bubble? Will those emerging new space firms go away in the next 2 to 3 years? Is this just a fade and we will go back to big rockets which are built by very well-established firms, and those whole space startup scene will vanish like the dot-com bubble in the 2000s? We have to look at the single firms and see what they are doing. We have to look closely. And I will now talk about some firms after the concept of Tutwat. So are they doing something, or are they just talking about it? I fit as many new space firms in one picture, there's a little cut off, as I could. And now we'll try to give my opinion, I have to say personal opinion, if they are promising or if they are not. First of all, let's start with Blue Origin, which may be, in terms of prominence, second to SpaceX. Blue Origin was founded in the 2000s, 2 years earlier actually than SpaceX, by Amazon billionaire Jeff Bezos. They specialize in space tourism. Their currently operational rocket is called New Shepard, after Alan Shepard, the first US astronaut in space. The interesting thing about Blue Origin is their relatively low launch cadence. So they just recently tested their new Shepard rocket. They had a little, even a little dummy on it called Mannequin Skywalker. And that was very successful. But this was just after a 14-month pause since the last launch before that. And that is, in space terms, a very long pause, especially if you know that there was no crash or something. The last test was also successfully, but they just took the 40 months to develop a whole new rocket. And that fact is caused by the deep pockets of Jeff Bezos. Jeff Bezos is sometimes the richest man, sometimes the second richest man alive, and he puts a lot of money into Blue Origin. At some point it was about $300 million, and I think it's now even more. And so they have not to think about revenue income at any point in the future, in the next 2 to 3 years, in contrast to SpaceX, for example, which have to think about that, because Elon Musk is rich too, yes, but not nearly as rich as Jeff Bezos, and he doesn't want or can't fund his firms as much as Jeff Bezos does. So Blue Origin does something, but they are not very fast, not very volatile like some other firms, but they are steady. They are also currently developing the new Shepard, the new Glenn, named after John Glenn, the first US astronaut to orbit the Earth, which will at some time in the future rival the Falcon Heavy in orbital payload capability. But this rocket is still in development. This is just computer rendering at this time. So put a green check mark on it, so I think it's promising, but slowly moving. Next firm is Rocket Lab. They launched this year the first rocket from New Zealand, and their rocket is called the Electron rocket, because their engine is not electrical, but the turbo pumps on the engine are solely electrical, which is unique to rockets. And they have a small rocket. They focus at this time on CubeSats or something bigger as CubeSats, but CubeSats are the next big thing in spaceflight. I will talk about that later. And they are very promising. They tried to launch their second rocket this December, but had to scrap their launch 3 times due to weather and some problems at the engine, but they will try next spring again. Yeah, I think they are very promising. They move continually forward. They are very open about their progress, and their first rocket launch worked very well. So, next thing, Virgin Galactic. You might know them also, funded by Richard Branson. They have their spaceship 2, which is hooked up under a plane, and then at some altitude the rocket ship will accelerate and then go on a suborbital trajectory into space. They had some years ago a very big accident where one of their test pilots died. But I think at this point in time, they are at that point where they were before the accident. And they had their first test flights now this year, and they had a big setback with this accident, but also very deep pockets by their funder, and they are moving forward. I am not as sure as with Blue Origin, because they are already split up the space tourism part and the satellite launching part into 2 firms. So maybe they will drop one of the firms in the future, but they are doing something. And that's the main point. Tuvat, there are a lot of firms, they don't do something. Worldview, not technically a space flight firm. They build stratospheric balloons. But the interesting thing about Worldview is they built the first flight controller for stratospheric balloons. So they tested it for the first time this year, and they can maintain altitude and in some margins their position in the air for 24 hours, and they will go up to 48 and even at some later point in time 72 hours, and that's very opportune for payloads with which you want to observe the Earth or some astronomical object, which could be done with a satellite. But if you don't want to spend so much money on it or have a payload which is very critical and you don't want to explode, you it's opportune to put it on a balloon because they are not as risky and not as expensive and can do in some with some limitation the same job as a satellite. And at some later time, they also will build a man-rated crew capsule, and then you can do space tourism in the atmosphere. Planet Labs are a satellite provider. They have currently the biggest satellite fleet in the world, with I think something about 170 plus minus satellites. And they at one time launched 88 satellites with one launch, which is the record with some other satellites with the most satellites in one launch. They have very small CubeSats called DoveSats, which observe the Earth, and they are very flexible, they are very fast moving. They demonstrated that with some emergency regions where they provided for free real-time pictures of earthquake regions to aid rescue workers. And they also demonstrated with that they can move very fast and take pictures from different point of Earth at a very short period. And they actually, their mission control is a small office in Berlin, which is very funny. There are just two guys sitting all time in mission control and steer the largest satellite fleet in the world. And they are currently, they're all the time they are launching their satellites on any CubeSat. CubeSat launch, there are at least one or two DoveSats in the last year. So it was my perception. That's very small. I hope you can see it. Bigelow Aerospace. They want to build space stations. They started, Bigelow is a big hotel millionaire, and his firm wants to build expandable space stations. Currently, you might have heard about that, they have the BEAM, the Bigelow Expandable Activity Module, hooked up to the ISS, a small demonstration let's say room for the ISS, and it worked very well. The mission of the BEAM was extended for the second time now in the last month, and it is very promising, especially in combination with the Deep Space Gateway, which they said they want to build parts of the Deep Space Gateway, also this translunar space station also. So where are we now? We are here. So we have green check marks. Now we are moving on to yellow question marks. So firms I'm not so sure about. First we have Zero to Infinity, very interesting name, very interesting project. They want to build balloons and then hook up a rocket to that balloon called Blue Star. At first, the first time I heard about it, I said this will never work. But they demonstrated this year with a small rocket launch from a stratospheric balloon. It worked very well, but it's very early stage. And like I will show in the next firm, if one big investor pulls out, your firm is history. And so they can go bankrupt at any time, which is not the case with the other firms, which are a bit more stable. But this balloon rocket is a very interesting project. It's very funny to watch. So Vector Space, they went bankrupt actually last year because one big investor pulled out. They had to furlough, leave without pay the whole staff. They were auctioned off, the whole firm were auctioned off to some Ukrainian investor. So this firm technically exists, but in the last half year there was no mention about that firm. And Vector Space, was it Vector Space? I just lost the red that line. So Vector Space is still existing, but we'll see. So the next firm is Stratolaunch Systems. they built this monstrosity, which is called Strato Launcher. That's actually two 787 planes hooked together in the middle, and is currently the widest plane in history. And they want to hook a rocket at this part, and then launch it from some altitude. Plane-based rocket launchers are not a new thing. There's the Pegasus rocket, which was launched some years ago, but they want it in a commercial way. They are funded actually by Paul G. Allen, which is a Microsoft millionaire. So you see a lot of millionaires doing a lot of stuff. They have not done any more than that. They drove the plane out of the hangar, drove it around on the runway, tried what happened if they actually moved that plane, but they didn't take off. So, Strato launch, still yellow question mark. Sea launch, I call this the zombie of new space. Sea launch is actually a very old firm, emerged from the Soviet Union. They bought an oil drilling platform and launched some rockets from that, but then they exploded very spectacular. You can look it up on YouTube, and went bankrupt immediately after that. But they, at some time last year, re-emerged and said they want to do that again. They want to launch rockets from sea again. But there's nothing really happened there, but they are not dead yet, but not yet alive. So, we're coming in the part where we talk about the failures. X-Core Space was a firm located at Spaceport America in the Mojave Desert, where also Virgin Galactic is located. They wanted to build a small crew-rated spacecraft. But also the founders pulled out. One founder was even hired by SpaceX, so he said, "I go to SpaceX, goodbye, look after yourself." And then one after another, I think four founders were there, and then there was one last founder, and then the firm went bankrupt. It was a very promising project. They had very interesting aerodynamics testing objects, so they had no aerodynamics testing canal, so they hooked up their wings and their rudders to a truck and drove the launchway very fast, and so tested their aerodynamics on a truck, but they don't exist anymore. ARCA emerged this year. They wanted to build a rocket with an aerospike engine, so an engine without a nozzle, which has a big spike in the middle, and through aerodynamic forces, the rocket exhausts are pulled in the middle. The firm were very promising, but now the CEO is currently under investigation, and I think already on trial for fraud and embezzlement, so not looking good there. And their rocket they built, was just a mock-up with wood, so not real a real rocket, but they shot it off on a big truck, so everyone thought, oh yes, they built a rocket, very good, but now it's all a scam. So you see, we have some promising things, some less promising things, and some failures. And I think in the next 2 to 3 years, actually, we will know if there is a bubble. Next 2 to 3 years, SpaceX will demonstrate their crew capabilities. Blue Origin will unveil their new big rocket. Rocket Lab will have some functional rocket at that time. And then I think the whole scene will consolidate. I think we will see a lot more red crosses on that wall in the next 2 to 3 years. But as in every new scene, there are some big failures, and I think some firms will emerge. But if it fails, if it fails spectacularly, like saying SpaceX goes bankrupt, or some other big firm, or Blue Origin goes away, that, if it happens, will also happen in the next 2 to 3 years due to their development stages. So, the future of new space. Let's talk a bit about that. what will also happen in the next 2 to 5 years, let's say, will be commercial space stations. I talked about Bigelow Aerospace. They will launch their big standalone space station in the next 2 years, more or less. And we will see that in some form. I don't know what it will become if we have something like we have commercial parts of the ISS and we have governmental parts on the ISS, or we have a lot of small commercial space stations, but it will happen. Tourism is still a thing that's happening all the time and don't happening all the time. You could buy Virgin Galactic tickets on Amazon at some point, but this went away. I think tourism will be something for the elite, but not something that many people could afford. So I think that's not a big business. Everyone says so commercial space, the most people think about tourism, but that's a very small part. We will see commercial moon bases and commercial Mars bases at some point in the next 2 to 3 decades. I think we will see the first man or woman on the Mars in the next decade or two, I think at least to our lifetimes. And the question I want to ask here is, the Treaty on Principles Governing the Activities of States in the Exploration and Use of Outer Space, including the Moon and other celestial bodies, talks about states, not companies. So what happens if a company establishes a base on, let's say, the Moon and says, this is company property now, and you can't go in this or that crater? There is some discussion if this treaty applies on companies. But if you look at the current state of capitalism, it could be very realistic that we have no-go zones on other celestial bodies due to company property. And if it comes to the details, who is there to enforce this treaty on Moon if there are just companies landing there? So my question, or with the thought I want to end this talk, is should we leave the exploration of space to these new space firms? I have the feeling that especially with SpaceX, there are a lot of people, especially here at Congress, who are very happy about SpaceX, what they do. It's very interesting, yes, but I see a big problem there if we don't watch out that we have governmental, or let's say in case of ESA, European space programs which could rival or cooperate those new space firms. But because I don't want, or I hope we don't get a Silicon Valley on the Moon, because that will bring a lot of problems. So I'm open to discussion and questions now. Thank you. I have a bit of a shameless self-plugging. This is my podcast in German, but let's talk about your questions.
Thank you. Are there any questions?
No?
No questions?
Da hinten.
Oh. Hi, thank you for your talk. So one thing that I kind of missed in your presentation was the distinction between orbital flights and suborbital flights.
Yes.
So in particular, if you look at Virgin Galactic and what Blue Origin is doing right now, they have suborbital vehicles, right?
Yes.
And these are like orders of magnitudes easier to build than an orbital launch system, because you just need like a lot less delta V to get into 100 kilometers above the Earth, rather than getting around the Earth at 7 kilometers per second. So do you want to comment on that?
Yes, I want to. That's a very good question. But as I said, Blue Origin is developing the new Glenn, which will be capable to launch orbital vehicles. And I think Virgin Galactic has, I talked about their split up, they are parts of tourism, and I think tourism will stay suborbital for Virgin Galactic, but they have a different firm, I forgot the name from them, something with Virgin. They want to launch satellites and want to build an orbital capable vehicle or launcher. So yes, suborbital is on magnitudes easier, but if you think about it this way, the biggest part of the rocket will stay suborbital. So the booster of the Falcon 9 will stay suborbital. The upper stages can deorbit. So it's I think, yes, from the speed, it's a big jump. But in my opinion, it's not a big jump from the technology. Sorry.
Okay, thanks.
So, more questions? None? Oh, one?
I have just one question. What do you think about the Sabre engine, which is currently developed in the UK?
Yes, Sabre engine. Not much. That's technology. That's very innovative. Yes, but so for those of you who don't know what a Sabre engine is, that's an engine which combined air breathing jet engine and the rocket engine. So if you have a rocket engine, you bring your air or your oxidizer with you, and you have your jet engine, you pull the air from the atmosphere. And if you combine those parts, you don't need to bring as much oxidizer with you, because you can use the air if you're still in the atmosphere. And this combination of technology is currently developed with the Sabre engine. And that is something that is all the time happening too, and all the time not happening. And I think that is something we will not see in the near future applied to any working vehicle. I think we will see some test vehicles, but not in some practical use. Any questions or discussion? Yes.
Like you said in your talk, you hope that the first person on Mars, or you feel that the first person on Mars is going to be categorized by the employee, not by the nation. Why do you see a problem with that?
Yes. I think what you thought is. It is good not to judge by nation, so it's better to judge by employee. Yes, I think it's good that we move away from nationalism in spaceflight. We have still big nationalism. You just need to watch some Mike Pence speeches about space and replace the word America for Germany, and then you have the Third Reich. But like I said, I don't want to have the turbo capitalism of Silicon Valley exported to Moon or Mars. And if you think it about that way, the first person was a SpaceX employee, then we will have the same problem. Then we have just replaced national states with firms which act like national states. And then we have the same problem with the no-go areas, with company property, with capitalism. And I think that's maybe as big as a problem as nationalism.
Is this on? Okay.
Yes.
So you talked a lot about new space, but I'm wondering, where does old space fit into this picture? Because there are a lot of companies who have
yes.
a lot of resources and a lot of experience, and of course they, you know, first they ignore you, then they laugh at you about you, and then you win. But still, they might adapt and develop new rockets that are also reusable or have at least reusable first stages. And I believe that. Some of these old space companies are trying to do that. So where do you think they fit into this picture? Do you think they will survive and adapt? Or do you think, you know, new space is just going to, like, take over?
Yes. If you look at the prices of rocket launchers, for example, from the ULA or from Arianespace, you see that with the development and practical use of the Falcon 9, they dropped their prices heavily. There was some sort of spaceflight monopoly happening, where they said a rocket launch at this magnitude costs, let's say, $60 million. It can't be done cheaper. Then SpaceX came around and said it can be done cheaper. And then all the old space firm, let's say, said, oh yes, it can be done cheaper. And suddenly the prices all dropped. Collectively. And so I think old space firms have to adapt. And I think the biggest problem which old space has, like let's say some old space firm is Orbital ATK, which were bought by Northrop Grumman, and Northrop Grumman was already around for the Apollo program. I think Grumman built the lunar lander, and Orbital ATK built some big parts of the space shuttle. And they are now forming this big conglomerate of Orbital, ATK, Northrop Grumman. That's one firm now, and they are very slow in changing. And this whole SLS thing is not about building a rocket, but keeping jobs. This whole SLS thing is just a job provider for the states that formerly built the space shuttle. Now didn't want to lose those space jobs, and the Congress looked after that all the firms who built the space shuttle are now building SLS, but it has nothing to do with development of any kind of usable rocket or practical rocket. So those old space firms have to move away from relying on the government providing some sort of rocket building opportunity for them to gain the money, and have to look at some things the new space firms are doing, for example, building everything in-house like SpaceX does. And I think, yes, they have to adapt or they will die.
But
yeah, oops.
Maybe a small annotation to this. I'm working for one of these commercial, but the old ones you said, Airbus.
Yes.
And I'm not directly working in the space division of Airbus, but I know a little bit from them.
Yes.
And maybe it should be noted that Airbus is totally capable of building a rocket and a spaceship, because they already did it. The ATV is more or less a complete Airbus product.
Yes.
And they also are currently developing and already built the first prototype of the what's it called, for Orion, the part that
yes.
supplies it and has the engines. It's based on the ATV design, etc.
Yes.
But from my perspective, I have inside the company, they're only driven by profit, and so they don't see it profitable to you know, to have to be in the news with being the guy who landed somewhere or something like this. They just supply it. And interestingly, that should be known is that, for example, Airbus, and that they are also American companies, they are a huge supplier for all these new companies, because I was told that doing the integration, what all these new companies do, is the easy part. The hard part is to develop the hardware that is capable to operate in space reliably. And reliability is the main issue here.
Yes.
Other things are solvable, but this is where you really need to have know-how, and nobody can replace it. So, but the point here is, don't forget the old commercials one, because they are the basis for all this. And without them, nothing would go on.
Yes. Yes, of course. If it there's at some parts of the internet a big fight between old and new space, and I don't want to paint this picture black and white. Sorry if it looked that way. Of course, old space can do new space stuff too. And SpaceX didn't invent the rocket flight. They also relied heavily on NASA know-how, for example. And there's cooperation going on between old and new space, and I think that you can't pin new space and old space on single firms, but I think you can do it on the way they're thinking about, back to philosophy, we are thinking about doing business in space. And for example, look at the Ariane rocket, where they just got a bit too greedy with the Ariane 5 to build a space vehicle launching some sort of space shuttle, what's called Hermes spacecraft. And now they have a big rocket without a Hermes spacecraft and not a very flexible small launcher. And also Ariane Space dropped their prices very heavily after the Falcon 9. So yes, old space can be innovative too, but they have to adapt on the new environment with more competition and less governmental supply of jobs or opportunity to build something.
So, any more Any more questions?
Definitely.
Oh, one.
I'm not that knowledgeable about the amount of space missions that's going on, but
yes.
Has the total economy about in space flight grown in the last 10 years?
Yes, yes, it has heavily, especially in the part of satellites, satellite providers in the small to medium region, and that what I mean with bubble. They grow very fast, very much, and maybe this bubble will burst, maybe not. We will see in the next 2 to 3 years. But it has grown. Yes, that's the boom going on. It's called satellite boom. There are a lot of very small. I can't talk about them all. I just picked the biggest. There are a myriad of small firms who are building some sort of satellite or part of a satellite or even just selling space on a satellite. And that economy is growing very fast, very big. So I think...
More questions? Okay. Yeah, thanks again.
Thank you.